What's going on, guys? It's Jimmy here with your $1,400 third stimulus check update. How is it going? I hope you're making it through the weather as it's still snowing here in Ohio. I think it's let up a little bit, but yeah, we're covered in snow. Let me know how you are. First up in this stimulus check update, we're going to go to the White House press briefing with White House Press Secretary Jen Psaki on the latest on the third stimulus check update, the latest details and news. If you're new to the channel, make sure to subscribe down below so you don't miss out on new updates on the third stimulus check, as well as the other things we covered, such as the $3,000 child stimulus checks, the student loan forgiveness, Social Security increases, mortgage and rental assistance, and more. And hit the like button for us. It really helps out our channel. All right, here we go, directly to the White House.
All right, I have a couple of items for all of you at the top. A lot of you have asked, maybe not in this room, but in general, what's next? What are we focused on next? And the answer is the president is going to continue working on getting the American Rescue Plan passed. That is his top priority. He is traveling to Wisconsin later this evening, as you know, to have a conversation, engage with the American people about his plans to get the pandemic under control, to put people back to work, and Congress is continuing to do their job over the course of the coming weeks. We're looking forward to making progress. There's also news out this morning about a foreclosure moratorium extension. Some of you may have seen. The COVID crisis has triggered a housing affordability crisis with more than 10 million homeowners behind on mortgage payments, and communities of color at even greater risk of eviction and foreclosure. Today, the administration is taking another step to bring urgent action, relief to the American families struggling to keep a roof over their heads. This is something the president talked about on day one. We talked about on day one, but today the Departments of Housing and Urban Development, Veterans Affairs, and Agriculture announced they will extend and expand the foreclosure relief programs, building on the steps President Biden spoke about a couple of weeks ago. These critical protections were due to expire in March, but as part of today's announcement, the foreclosure moratorium and the mortgage forbearance enrollment window will be extended through June 30th. The administration will also provide up to 6 months of additional mortgage payments to forbearance for borrowers who entered forbearance on or before June 30th, 2020. These actions will bring needed relief to most of the 2.7 million homeowners currently in forbearance and extend forbearance options for nearly 11 million homeowners with government-backed mortgages across the country. It's critical, it remains critical, that Congress pass the American Rescue Plan to deliver more aid to struggling homeowners. As we speak, or maybe a little earlier, depending on when the call wrapped, Jeff Sessions had a regular call with a number of governors, our COVID response coordinator, of course, providing them with key updates on our pandemic response, as well as hearing from them about the work they're doing on the ground. As a part of that call, he announced that we're increasing the vaccine supply to 13.5 million doses per week that will go out to states. This is a 57% increase from the amount states received when the president was inaugurated. So since then, obviously, we have announced a couple of increases over the course of time. We're also announcing that we're doubling the supply to our pharmacy program. When we announced that, we said it would be building over time. So this today's announcement amounts to 2 million doses going to local pharmacies this week, and this program will expand access in neighborhoods across the country so that people can call and make an appointment and get their shot conveniently and quickly. Eventually, as supply increases, more than 40,000 pharmacy locations nationwide will be providing COVID-19 vaccines through this program. This is a critical part of our plan. Second to last, but certainly not least, we opened healthcare.gov as planned and as we had announced for a special enrollment period until May 15th to provide all Americans the opportunity to sign up for health insurance. They can go to healthcare.gov. Nearly 9 million Americans are eligible for free or subsidized health insurance. Finally, as you know, a brutal Arctic mass impacted the central United States this weekend, bringing freezing rain, sleet, and snow from Texas to the mid-Atlantic. On Saturday night, Texas Governor Greg Abbott requested a federal emergency declaration due to the severe weather storm. Homeland Security Advisor Dr. Liz Sherwood Randall called Governor Abbott on Sunday to let him know that the president had immediately granted his request to help meet the state's mass care and shelter needs. Yesterday, Liz additionally called the other governors in the storm's path on behalf of the president, including Governor Ivey of Alabama, Governor John Bel Edwards of Louisiana, Governor Laura Kelly of Kansas, Governor Reeves of Mississippi, and Governor Kevin Stitt of Oklahoma. She expressed the president's strong commitment to ensuring that the federal government proactively does everything it can to support state and local officials in preparing for and responding to the events that impact our citizens. We will, of course, continue to monitor the storm's updates in the days ahead. With that, go ahead.
The president is changing gears this week, obviously looking beyond the hill to get out and sell this plan to the American people. Is this a sign that he recognizes that he's not likely to get Republicans in Washington on board?
He certainly wouldn't agree with that. I would say that the president's view of the package, the president has not shifting gears. He has been focused every single day, even as others have not, which is understandable, on engaging with partners, stakeholders, people who agree with him, people who don't agree with him, on getting this package through. This is an opportunity, as you noted, to go out and have a conversation with the people of Wisconsin, people who agree with him, people who disagree with him. But if you look at the polls, they are very consistent. The vast majority of the American people like what they see in this package. And that should be an indication or should be noted by members of Congress as they consider whether they're going to vote for it or not.
So is he hoping then that these visits will help build pressure on members of Congress?
No, his objective is really to make sure he is engaging directly with the people who are impacted by the pandemic, who are impacted by the economic downturn, who are worried about whether they're going to get a shot, who don't know where to get information, who are worried about whether they're going to be able to put food on the table. That's the focus of this trip. Obviously, Republicans in Congress will have to make their own choice about whether they support the final package. It's still working its way through Congress, but the vast majority of the public supports it, including the vast majority of most members' constituents. So it's really a question for them.
Also, a quick update on vaccines. If you're hit hard by this weather, there is literally millions of people out of power right now, including medical facilities and distribution facilities for the vaccines. So that likely will be pushed back at least a few days with delays because of the power outages that are going on right now with the extreme storms that are basically still going on in the eastern part of the United States. And I believe there's another front coming too. So yeah, stay tuned. Buckle up.
The president yourself have frequently cited what you describe as the failures or the shortcomings of the Trump administration as it relates to their response to COVID. We're now nearly a month into this administration. Does the Biden administration now own the coronavirus response?
Well, certainly the president of the United States owns the response to the COVID pandemic. That's why he is focused on it every single day. However, it's important for the American people to know what we inherited when the president came into office. And what he inherited was not enough supply, not enough vaccinators, not enough places for vaccinations to happen. Communities had been left to fend for themselves. And so that's what he's been focused on and working on. But certainly, if he were standing here, he would say that's why it's the issue he wakes up every morning and is focused on, because addressing it is what's on the minds of the American people. And he's the president. It's his responsibility to focus on it.
Ooh, a little bit of tension on that question. Let me know your thoughts.
Jen, first on the vaccine, you were talking earlier about how the president wants to address the concerns of everyday Americans with vaccine and the pandemic. One way the White House Chief of Staff proposed doing that last month was creating a national clearinghouse for vaccine information that would either be available online or through a hotline. Can you update us on the progress of that? Is that close to being rolled out?
I don't have any update for you, other than to convey that our team is always considering a range of options to make information more accessible, ensure more people, more of the American public know how they can get a vaccine, when they can get a vaccine, where they can go to get a vaccine. That's part of the reason the president is, of course, traveling to Wisconsin, but I don't have any update for you on a clearinghouse or a website.
So it sounds like that's only still under consideration. Is that something that's really not in the works at the moment?
There are a range of options under consideration, and their focus is on taking the steps that are the most effective and efficient and prioritizing those in the order through which they would help the American people.
Now on the situation in Texas, beyond disaster relief, is the administration considering any actions to address not only Texas's power grid, but the power grid in the central United States that seem to really struggle with the winter weather, in addition to some other issues? I know Texas is not really part of the national power grid. Is the administration looking at that situation and considering any kind of actions in the short term to address it?
Well, I think our focus right now is ensuring that the millions of people across Texas who are impacted by the storm get the relief they need. Obviously, that's why the president and his Homeland Security advisor took very quick action over the weekend. Clearly, as there are investments in the future, in energy forms, across the country, they'll need to plan for inclement weather. But I think that's a discussion and conversation. It's a little bit down the road.
A couple of quick questions. Both Senators Joe Manchin and Kyrsten Sinema have both expressed some opposition to increasing the minimum wage as it's laid out currently in the proposal in the Senate. And I wondered, is President Biden open to lengthening the period of time over which the minimum wage can be increased? So, for example, you know, getting it to $15 by 2030, is he open to potentially extending the timeline there to get more people on board?
Well, we'll let the process play out through the Senate, through the House first and through the Senate, as they're negotiating what the final components will look like in a package. The president put an increase in the minimum wage in the initial package because he thinks it's important for American men and women who have a full-time job, working hard, to have a decent wage, and he thinks it's a long past time to raise the minimum wage. But we'll let the process see itself through, and I'm not going to negotiate what he'd be open to and not from the podium.
And that's really going to be one of the key points to getting this third stimulus check officially passed. House Speaker Nancy Pelosi says that the bill will be completed this week and will be voted on by the House of Representatives. But then when it goes to the Senate, remember that $15 an hour minimum wage is in the third stimulus check package. But when it goes to the Senate, it's going to be a little bit trickier because they need every single Democrat to vote yes on it. They need 50 Democrats, and then the tiebreaker vote will go to Kamala Harris, on which they can then play their Trump card or their reconciliation card, which will pass the bill with only 51 votes. But if they don't get every single Democrat to vote yes, then they're going to have to amend it or tweak it. And we know that both Joe Manchin and Kyrsten Sinema, two Democratic senators, are not for the $15 an hour minimum wage. So the real question is going to be, will they pass it basically for the greater good, saying, well, they agree with 90% of the package, and there's one thing in there they don't agree with? Joe Manchin says that he agrees with a minimum wage from $7.25, which is what it is now, to up to $11. That's what he proposed in his state of West Virginia. And Kyrsten Sinema also says she's not for the $15 an hour minimum wage. And as you can see on here, remember, the minimum wage doesn't go up immediately. The first year it goes up, or the first day it's passed, will go up to $2.25. Then it goes up $1 to $1.50 per year, which isn't that crazy, but it does double in the course of 5 years, which is kind of a lot when you think about it, especially because the cost of goods and services will go up, because if McDonald's and Walmart and every place that has minimum wage people across the U.S. has to pay double for their labor, it only makes sense that prices are going to have to go up. But we've seen one of the reporters say there, interestingly, that maybe a compromise would be to make the $15 an hour minimum wage happen by the year 2030. Could be a compromise. Or if they can't get both those Democrats to say yes, they may have to throw this out of the bill and then come back later to it, possibly after the pandemic is over, because there's a big fear that this will hurt a lot of small businesses even more, as already over 20% of small businesses have already gone out of business, and this would put more pressure on small businesses to pay higher wages than they do now. So those are the kind of couple options. They may have to compromise, they may have to throw it out, but I think that they're going to try to pass it with the $15 an hour minimum wage in there and basically see if they can get all 50 Democrats to say yes. The other issue is they need the parliamentarian, which is a lady in the Senate, to say yes, that this is actually able to be passed through the budget reconciliation process. So it has several different steps that it has to go through to be finalized in that bill, but there's probably a 50-50 chance that this $15 an hour minimum wage does not make it past the finish line when they do pass the third stimulus check package.
Thank you, Jack. With the President Trump's impeachment behind us, do you believe an impediment has been removed in terms of passing the COVID Relief Act? I mean, was that a distraction for anyone on the Hill or in the White House?
It certainly wasn't for us. And members of Congress on the Hill continue to do their job in having conversations at the committee level. It was obviously an important week in our nation's history. The president put out a statement from the president on Saturday, and we understand why there was a focus on it from, of course, the media and also from many in the public. But we have said from the beginning that the president would remain laser focused on getting the American Rescue Plan passed. That's exactly what he did last week and what he'll continue to do this week. And we are pleased with the urgency we've seen from members of Congress as well.
So yeah, let me know your thoughts down below in the comments. I will have new stimulus updates for you coming out. Remember, new videos come out every day at 10 a.m., 3 p.m., 8 p.m., and 11 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Make sure to subscribe down below. It's completely free. Just click the subscribe button and then click the bell icon to all notifications. You'll get notifications for at least the first three videos of the day, but not the 11 p.m. one. You just got to remember to show up for that one on YouTube and search for It's Jimmy, our channel name, if you need to. You can click this top video here to watch my newest stimulus check video next. And this video teaches you how to start your own business selling products on Amazon FBA. I have dozens of students that have replaced their 9-to-5 income selling products on Amazon, and I teach them how to do that. Click on one of those videos to watch them next. Thanks, guys, and I will see you in the next video.